In this video, we will take a look at the worst imperfection for axially compressed cylinders. First, let's start with a short introduction to axially compressed cylinders. We have here our test cylindrical structure, which is placed in a testing rig. And if we apply axial shortening to the structure, we get this diagram. We have here the axial shortening versus the reaction force, and we have here the maximum reaction force, which is the classical buckling load. If we exceed the classical buckling load, this happens. We have a reduction in the reaction force. Then we have here a minimum, which is defined as the post-buckling load. And as you can see, we have large deformations of the shell surface. Okay, then in summary, we have here the classical buckling load. Here is the post-buckling load. And there's a significant reduction of the load carrying capacity due to buckling. Okay, let's go to the next slide. Here we can see the classical equation for the buckling load, which depends on the elasticity modulus, the Poisson's ratio and the wall thickness. By using the classical buckling load, we can determine the so-called knockdown factor, which is shown on the right side. The knockdown factor is the ratio of an experimental determined buckling load to the classical buckling load. And if we have, for example, an experimental buckling load of 100 kilonewtons and the classical buckling load is 100, then we have a theoretical knockdown factor of 1, which is the expected classical solution, which can be seen in this diagram as green line. However, as you can see in the experimental data, the black dots, we have a large scatter. For example, like here, for a radius to wall thickness ratio of 800, we have a knockdown factor of 0.26, which means that the measured test buckling load was only about a quarter of the expected classical buckling load. So as you can see, there is a significant deviation between analytical and experimental buckling load for cylindrical shells under axial compression, and the deviation is in this example up to 74%. And now we come to a more detailed example. I have here a testing series from a paper from 1936. It's a German paper. And here you can see a table with the following values. And as you can see, I have plotted the experimental knockdown factors in a diagram versus the Bartholf parameter, which depends on the length, the radius and the thickness of the shell. Okay, as you can see, we have here the knockdown factor equation versus the Bartholf parameter, and then we have an expected knockdown factor highlighted by the blue line, the threshold knockdown factor. And you can see that basically all test knockdown factors are below this line. And now we will look at this shell. This shell has the lowest knockdown factor of all shells, and I have already determined the load displacement curve. You can see that the classical buckling load is about 2.84 kilonewtons and the post-buckling load is about 535 newtons. So as you can see, that the ratio of both is about 0.81, which is exactly the same knockdown factor as in the test load. So that means that in the test imperfections occurred, which reduce the buckling load to a value of the post-buckling load. And in this video, I will show you how to model an imperfection which is is this structural behavior? In this part of the video, we will create the numerical model. Okay, let's go to Abacus first. We rename it to LBA. Then we go to part shell extrusion. And we use create circle center and perimeter. First point is 0 and 0, second point is 250 and 0. And the extrusion is 255. Okay, now we have our base model. Let's create some planes. Oh, 100 and... Oh, the other planes. Okay, then we go to partition phase and we select the planes. Okay, this one and this one. Cool. And then we go to material and the material is not that relevant, so we just use steel. 280,000, 208,000 and 0.3. Okay, and now the section manager, shell homogeneous, and thickness is 0.06. And then we go here, create, and done now to assembly. Okay, then we go to interaction. Create some points 000 and 00255. Now looks okay. Okay, and let's create some sets. Set first RP1 and we select RP1, then RP2. And we select RP2. Then set RP1. And we select only the edge. Okay, and set RP2. Okay, now we go to constraint manager, create rigid body and tie, and then we go to sets and set RP2 and RP2, and the same for the other side, set RP1 and RP1. Okay, then we go to load, to step first, create, first we will perform a linear buckling analysis, first 10, okay, and load, create, initial. And we select RP2 and we lock all degrees of freedom. And then we select RP1 and select all except U3. Okay. And then concentrated force at RP1. Of 1. And now we go to mesh and for very thin shells We need actually a thin mesh or a very fine mesh. I have to check in. I have a script to calculate the mesh density. Import NumPy SNP and then we copy also all term here. Nah. Okay. So it's 0.5 times np.sqrt radius times thickness. So 250 times 0.6. Yes. Okay, and this is the estimated mesh element length. Okay, then like 2. Oh, this looks very fine actually. How many elements? 100,000. Okay, we go with 100,000. Okay, now we go to job and create the LPA. Okay, and we save the model as post buckling. Okay, and I will just submit. And in the meantime, I will create the contact model. So we copy the model GNA 3D contact. Okay, we go to part again and we create a new part. Solid extrusion. I would say minus 260 and 5 and 260 and 0. And 520. Okay. Yeah, we create a new section, solid homogeneous. Now first we have to create a partition. Create a plane XZ. And create a partition. Partition. I think this one. Select the sketch plane and the edge. Okay, and the radius is 0 and 0 and 250 and 0. Done. Okay. Where is my here is it. Extrude the edge. Select one or more edges. Done. Extrude along direction. Select an extrude direction. This one. Okay, create partition, done. Okay, looks fine to me. Okay, now property and we create and this one. And section 2. Okay, now assembly. And we create. Okay, now we done and degrees, okay. And then we -260. Okay. I guess I will understand sometime. Hä? Select the endpoint? Zero seems fine. Okay. This looks better. Ah, oh, sorry about that. Okay. Okay, now we go to interaction and create shell to solid coupling. Select the shell edge surface. Ah, okay. This one done surface done. Okay. Okay, now we have to change this one. We just tie another. The back side. Okay. Then we go to step. Replace. General static general. Small imperfection here. Okay, and we deselect this. We also create a displacement. I don't know. One. What about about the LBA. It's still running, okay. Okay, and then we can create our standard GNA model. Think the let's create the jobs and then we will make a shortcut. Create GNA and create GNA 3D contact. I can create the next model also. Contact. Create a new part and this will be the extrusion also. Then we create the same as last time, 260 and 5 and 260 and 0. But now we want to create a small inclination. Hard to say how much the amplitude is. But let's do it like this. We remove this one here. Okay, and then we zoom in here. Okay, the distance from here, so this is 5. This point is minus 260. So I have no idea. Let's create, I say, this point has to be iterated. So let's create minus 260 and 5 point. Zero, zero, six. Oh, 0, 1. Yeah, I'm not sure. So it's very small. Very, very small. Okay, now we connect this point and this point. And then we connect this point and this point. And now we have a very small offset here, very small inclination. 520. Let's check where it is. I think it's here. So the distance from this point to this should be 5. Okay, then it's the other side. Distance from here to here. No. Okay. Then maybe this. Distance from here to here. Ah, here. It's 5.01. So a very small offset. Property, just sign the Material 2. Let's check something. I don't know which side. Ah, okay, it's we have to okay, this is the side, the top side is has the inclination, so I want to make sure that I use the right side, so let's create a marker. Here. Like here in the edge. Okay, let's check it again. Okay, let's. Okay, this part will be moved from here to here. Okay, and then again, like minus one. Now we go to interaction again, create general contact. Oh no, it's surface to surface contact. Surface to surface contact. Okay, the master surface. Okay, now we do it like this. We use part and remove. This is a master surface, done, and the slave, then we use this one, and we remove 3, okay, and we select this one, ah, surface, done, and property, contact, mechanical, frictionless, hard contact. Okay, and that's it, I guess. Assembly, mesh. Okay, but now we have to mesh the both parts. Okay, but that should be not the problem, I think. hard work. What is the distance from here to here? Ach ja, scheiße. Okay. So, we use create datum plane offset from here. Enter value. What is the direction? Flip. Okay, seems to be the correct distance and select plane, enter value, okay, and now we use this one, select plane, okay, and then this one. Okay, now this can be meshed, that's nice. Okay, and this one, actually don't know what the problem is here. Fifties. Yeah. Should be easy, I guess. -255 and 255. No, and 255 and -255. And then only selected this one edge. Okay. Select this edge, this edge, this edge. And this edge. Done. I don't know why we cannot. Let's try this one. Okay, now it works. Ah. 3D stress, yes. Actually, this part is not that important, I think. have to change this inter. No, this one again. Okay, it's also okay, it's also okay, but I think this is also not okay, yeah. Okay, this has to be changed as well. Master surface, again display manager, remove this, 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 and this. Ah. Done and slave. Okay. Okay, now it seems to work. Let's check if it's here. All is okay. Yes, 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 yes. Okay. Copy. Okay, in the next part, we will look at the results. This is a small correction part. We have to adjust some stuff. First off, I have increased the global size of the elements because the calculation takes forever otherwise. So we use a global size of 4 mm for the cylindrical shell. And also we have to use here also 4 mm for the part with the circular partition. Otherwise, calculation will have some errors because the element nodes don't match. Okay, so also 4 mm for this part, and this part is actually not that relevant here. We can use 10 mm. Okay, in the next part we look at the results. In this part of the video we look at the results of the analysis. First, we take a look at the linear bifurcation analysis. You can see the fine mesh. We turn off the mesh, and here you can see the linear buckling load. So our analytical buckling load is like this: 2848 newtons, and our linear buckling load from the FEM is like this. So we have a deviation of 1%. That's very good. Okay, then let's take a look at the geometrically nonlinear analysis. Let's take a look at the deformation behavior. So you can see that we have very many small buckles here because the shell is very thin. Yeah, and stop this. And the nonlinear buckling load is 2825 by 2848. Okay, so there's an error of about 1%. So that's still fine. Okay, this is our nonlinear model. Then we have created a model with the plate. And let's check what we have here. We have, I have only run the simulation until the buckling load. So here we have 2815. This is the deformation behavior. Okay, this is as expected. 2815 by 2848. So we have a slightly higher error, but still about 1%. Okay, and here is our model with the imperfection. I don't know if it's already the fitted model. Okay, it's already the fitted model. Then this should be the model with a slight imperfection. Yes. Okay, let's have a look at the. You can see clearly the incline load introduction. Maybe let's have it like this. No. And we can also turn off the plates. Okay, let's wait until the you can see clearly here the incline load application. Okay, and the expected, or no, the calculated buckling load is about 2469 by 2848. It's about 14% reduction. Okay, and we want to about 80% reduction. Okay, let's check the models. It has been a while. Here we have the shell. Now we have to look at the plates. Feature, section sketch. Okay, for our model with the small. Okay, now if we want to change the inclination, we have to use some constraints first. Go to add constraint, then fixed, and then we select this point here and click done. Then you have here the constraint feature, constraint symbol. Then we go to add dimension, select this point, and then click enter. And then we can change the value of the dimension using this feature, the add dimension, edit dimension. And then we can edit it like this, for example. And then we click OK and done. And then we just have to regenerate the feature. Okay, and let's check. I have iterated it until I have found the post buckling value and the inclination is 0.15 millimeters. Okay, if we change the inclination to 0.15 millimeters, we get a similar result as in the test. Okay, let's check. Oh, first let's use this view, save, and then let's check the result here. We use the view, go to the display manager, remove the plates, and then we look at the deformation behavior. You can see that we have here the deformation behavior. And there is the first dimple, or the first buckle, and from there on, the buckling pattern propagates. Okay, that's how it looks like. And the reaction force is about 535, so 535 by 248. And we have about the knockdown factor from the experiment. Okay, this illustration shows us our numerical model. We have a shell which has a length of 255 millimeters, and we have some kind of inclination which leads to an additional bending. And this inclination has on the largest point a length of 0.15 millimeters. And you can see that in reality, this would be impossible to spot with your eyes, because it's less than 1/1000 of the length. And this very small inclination leads to a buckling load reduction of 80%. Here's a summary of the load displacement curves. You can see the load displacement curve of the perfect shell. And you can see the load displacement curve of our worst imperfection model. And you see that our worst imperfection model actually gives quite a good approximation in terms of buckling load value when compared to the post-buckling load of the perfect shell. Okay, but you also see that the post-buckling load of the imperfect model is even lower. So that means there is no possibility to define a worst imperfection which leads to a minimum buckling load. And it is basically possible to reduce the buckling load to zero if you use this modeling strategy. However, if we assume the post-buckling load for different geometric configurations, we can actually define quite a well approximation for the experimental results of the testing series. So this means actually that the testing series, most of the shells had buckling load values which are so low that they can be approximated with the post-buckling load. Okay, that's it for this video. If you have some questions, please comment or shoot me an email to this address. Like the video, subscribe to the channel, and until next time.